Hello friends, myself Dr. Pooja Johari and I am here in front of you to discuss the grand test. ...185 of biochemistry. The biochemistry question starts from 117 to 133. Now, let's quickly start up with the discussion of the questions. Question number 117. Which of the following lipoproteins is likely to be elevated in the blood when a person on a fat-free carbohydrate-rich diet continues to grow obese? Now, before taking up the explanation of these questions, let's discuss what do you mean by the lipoproteins. 117 lipoproteins. Now see, it's clear from the word itself, lipoproteins means these are the aggregates of lipid and proteins. Now, what is the use of this protein actually? Now, all of you know that lipids are highly insoluble in water, so they need a carrier protein to be transported from one organ to another organ. Just the protein part of a lipoprotein is apoprotein. But when it combines with a lipid, it becomes a lipoprotein. So overall, if we see, there are four major types of lipoproteins: HDL, LDL, VLDL and chylomicrons. Now see, HDL, heavy density lipoprotein, it is considered to be the fastest moving fraction in terms of electrophoresis. Chylomicrons, it is clear from the word itself, chylomicrons means they are the first, you can say, the fats which are actually leaving the intestinal juice. So they are more in fat. Obviously, if they have more fat, they will have less of protein, and they are the slowest moving fraction. So, slowest, or you can say they are, this is the fraction which stays at the origin at the time of electrophoresis. HDL is considered to be the alpha fraction, VLDL is the beta, pre-beta. And this stays at the origin. Now, what happens is, to understand the metabolism fatty acid, we should know little bit about the exogenous pathway and the endogenous pathway. Exogenous pathway is the one which actually requires these chylomicrons, and endogenous pathway is the one which requires the VLDL. So, exogenous pathway is between, you can say, intestine to the liver, whereas VLDL starts from the liver to the extrahepatic tissues, and this VLDL is responsible for the synthesis of LDL, taking IDL as the receptor. Right. So, let's look at the options now of the question. Which of the protein is likely to be elevated when a person on a fat-free diet, rich diet, continues to grow obese? It is directly linked to the endogenous pathway, which is VLDL. So, the answer to this is very low density lipoproteins, which will actually increase, or it will lead to obesity also. And all of you must be familiar with certain terms like HDL is known as the good cholesterol. Why? Because it is responsible for reverse cholesterol transport, means the transport of cholesterol is in reverse direction, means it is taking cholesterol from the extrahepatic tissues, bringing it to the liver, where actually cholesterol is basically converted to the bile acids, like primary bile acids are there, secondary bile acids are there. Whereas LDL, if we say, on the other hand, LDL is responsible for the bad cholesterol. It is responsible for different CHDs in our body, right. So, the answer to this question is very low density lipoproteins. So, answer is very low density lipoproteins, which are responsible for the endogenous pathway, that is the pathway which takes place from the liver to other extrahepatic tissues. The next question, number 118, what does protoporphyrin level 100 microgram per dl indicate? Now see, first of all, again before starting up with this question, we should have a knowledge about what are porphyrins. What are porphyrins? What are protoporphyrins? Now, porphyrins are what? See, porphyrins are actually defined as those compounds which have a central metal attached to four tetrapyrrole rings. Now, if this central metal is iron, it becomes a iron porphyrin, and if it is say magnesium, it becomes a chlorophyll porphyrin. Iron porphyrin is nothing but heme, and all of us are familiar with this, that the synthesis of heme takes place in a body which involves two organelles, cytoplasm and mitochondria. Now, here I would like to bring one more thing into your notice, is that there are actually three pathways which involves two organelles. This is a very important question. Three pathways requiring two organelles. One is heme synthesis, which I just mentioned. Second is urea cycle, very important. And third is gluconeogenesis. So, these three processes require cytoplasm and mitochondria. This question has been asked in the exam also. Now, here we are asking about protoporphyrins. Now, see what happens is the synthesis of heme, partially it takes place in the cytosol and partially it takes place in the mitochondria. Precursor of heme is glycine and succinyl coenzyme A. Glycine and succinyl coenzyme A, in the presence of enzyme ALA synthase, forms ALA. ALA stands for aminolevulinic acid. This aminolevulinic acid undergoes dehydration, means condensation. It loses a molecule of water in the presence of enzyme ALA dehydratase, inhibited by lead. This ALA then forms prophobilinogen. This prophobilinogen, again by different reactions, it will form uroporphyrinogen, or you can say hydroxymethylbilane. This hydroxymethylbilane will obviously form coproporphyrinogen, then protoporphyrin, 9 protoporphyrin, and then finally in the end heme is synthesized. Now, the question arises, whenever any enzyme is deficient enzyme will lead to accumulation of porphyrins, leading to protoporphyrias, whether they are hepatic or whether they are erythropoietic. But here the question is, if the concentration of protoporphyrin exceeds, it is a question of lead poisoning. There is accumulation of protoporphyrins in urine which are excreted. So, the answer to this question is lead poisoning, which is actually inhibiting heme synthetase enzyme in one go and it is inhibiting ALA dehydratase in another go. So, automatically there will be the increase in the concentration of this protoporphyrin. Here you can see hemes, the enzyme here is heme synthetase. There is accumulation of increased concentration of protoporphyrin, right. So, the answer is lead poisoning. Then let us switch over to question number 119. The damage caused to the biological systems by UV radiations is by, now the see first look at the options: inhibition of DNA synthesis, formation of thymine dimers, ionization, DNA fragmentation. Whenever, always think this thing in mind, whenever there is a concept of this ultraviolet radiation, all of us are familiar with this, that DNA absorbs at UV range, and this absorption of DNA at UV range is actually due to the presence of the bases. Whenever UV radiation is there, it leads to the formation of thymine dimers. Actually, what happens is there is formation of these type of dimers, and the deficient enzyme is, this is very important, deficient enzyme here is UV endonuclease. UV endonuclease is the name of the enzyme which is actually, when deficient, there will be accumulation of dimer formation, which is strictly in response to the ultraviolet radiations. And the disorders which are associated to this, one very important is xeroderma pigmentosum, hyperpigmentation of the skin due to the deficiency of this UV nuclease, and it is actually a nucleotide excision repair mechanism. Similarly, another syndrome which is associated with this is Cochrane syndrome. So, these are actually due to this UV radiations. So, the answer to this question would be formation of thymine dimers. The reason behind this is deficiency of UV endonuclease enzyme is there. Is it clear? Then we move to question number 120. Which one of the following is false about inulins? Now, we are all familiar with inulins. What are inulins? Inulins are the homopolysaccharides formed from fructose, and that is why they are also known as fructosans. That is why they are also known as fructosans, kyunki they are the polymers of fructose, and they have been isolated from the roots of Dahlia. Another important point, and obviously the linkage between them is they have alpha 1,4 linkage, 1,4, or you can say 1,2 linkage also, kyunki fructose is there. So, there will be 1,2 linkage in that. They are formed of this fructose, and the holy solely function of inulins is they are actually meant for inulin clearance test. This inulin clearance test, again it is clear from the word itself, this inulin clearance test is actually required to estimate GFR. simple, some amount of inulin is given, and we have to see ki if it is being absorbed, then obviously, yeah, whatever amount of inulin we are given, it should actually be excreted in the urine of the patients as such. Right. So, options are present in root of Dahlia plants, yes, they are isolated from that. Storage homopolysaccharide, yes, they are the storage homopolysaccharides, they are known as fructosans. N-acetyl fructosamine is one of its component. No, N-acetyl fructosamine is not their component. Since they are homopolysaccharides, you know, homo means identical unit of polysaccharide is there, and that is only and only fructose. And this N-acetyl fructosamine is a derived form of fructose. It cannot be the component of inulins. So, the answer is, which of the following is false? N-acetyl fructosamine is one of its component. Fourth option is used to measure glomerular filtration rate. Just now I told you ki the major use of inulin clearance test is to measure this GFR. So, the answer to this question is C, N-acetyl fructosamine, which is not its component. Next question, number 121. Now, again, this is very important. Just by looking at the picture, you can find out Tata box, Tata, T-A-T-A. It is nothing but it is the promoter sequences which actually help in recognition and initiating the process of transcription. Answers, what are the options given? Silencer, promoter, enhancer, palindromic. It has to be promoter region. We will take this topic little bit in detail because this is very, very important. Now, see Tata box 121, TATA. What is transcription? Simple, it is the process of formation of RNA from DNA, and the RNA so produced is actually known as hnRNA, heterogenic or heavy nuclear RNA from DNA. Now, what happens is, you can say if there are actually three steps: initiation, elongation and termination. Initiation means we are just initiating. Enzyme required is RNA polymerase. This RNA polymerase in eukaryotes is of 1, 2 and 3 types. But in prokaryotes, this RNA polymerase exists in 5 subunits: alpha, alpha dash, beta, beta dash, and above all, sigma. This sigma plays a very important role. It does not have any role, no role in catalysis or catalytic activity, but it is required for the recognition of promoter sequences. Now, what are promoter sequences? Again, it is clear from the word itself, which are going to promote. Promote what? Transcription. Or they are the actual sequences which are starting this process. Now, all of us know the major difference between DNA and RNA is ki DNA has thymine and RNA has uracil instead of thymine. So, these you can say the strand of DNA which is going to synthesize RNA in 5 prime to 3 prime direction should have more of uracil component. That is why we say ki it is rich in Tata box, the promoter sequences which will form, kyunki adenine here it is going to base pair with uracil. We have to demarcate the two strands. One very important thing which I would like to bring it in your notice is this new strand is always synthesized in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime. So, out of the two DNA strands, only one acts as a template, which is obviously running in the direction 3 prime to 5 prime. And these promoter sequences are known as Pribnow sequences in prokaryotes and Hoggness in eukaryotes. They have their different positions, jaise minus 10 upstream, downstream, this is again minus 35 upstream, downstream to again these Tata sequences. But ultimately Tata sequences are the promoter sequences which are promoting the process of transcription, which are rich in TATA. So the answer to this question is promoter region. Then question number 122, the best method to identify single nucleotide polymorphism without a prior sequence information is? This is a very simple question. When we have to identify SNPs, now what are these SNPs? 122, question number, SNP is single nucleotide, single nucleotide polymorphism. Single nucleotide polymorphism means there is polymorphism. Polymorphism means one sequence is existing in 2-3 forms, but the polymorphism is along only a single nucleotide. Theek hai? So it is depicting what? It is depicting sequencing of genes, or it is depicting DNA sequencing, right? Single nucleotide polymorphism means there is existence of one more, you know, homologous sequences are there. That is what is polymorphism, but it is arising along a single nucleotide. So the answer to this question is simple DNA sequencing. One RFLP is also there, restriction fragment length polymorphism. It is what? Again a type of polymorphism, but it is revolving around multiple sequences. But here simple, it is actually revolving around single nucleotides. Then next, 123 question number, the amino acid sequence of lipoprotein A is homologous to which of the following proteins? Now it is this is simple, a very simple question. It is plasminogen. Basically what happens is, next question, this is actually LPA. A stands here for apoprotein, and it shows a structural resemblance with plasminogens. They have simply a apoprotein associated with this. LP stands for lipoprotein, and both of them function, ek tarah se antagonist function is there. It will induce fibrinolysis. So LPA has a structural resemblance to plasminogens, and it is going to affect the lysis of the clot. It is going to interfere with that, and they are actually degraded by the liver. The next question, enzyme which is active in well-fed state. Now this is a very important question, and it is very frequently asked in the exam. 124, well-fed state. See, well-fed state is obviously when we are, see there are three type of states actually. One is the fed state, one is the fasting state, and one is the starved state. Now see, if we see the RBCs, RBCs have glucose in the fed state, again glucose in the fasting state, and starvation, maybe they need glucose for energy in the starved state. Why? Because RBCs lack mitochondria, and glycolysis is the process which is actually operating in the cytosol, which is actually giving energy to the RBCs all the time. If for example heart is dependent on fatty acids इन फैट स्टेट, फास्टिंग में अगेन फैटी एसिड्स, बट इन स्टार्वेशन दे हैव टू डिपेंड ऑन कीटोन बॉडीज. इन ब्रेन, ब्रेन में फ्री फैटी एसिड्स कैन नॉट क्रॉस दिस ब्लड ब्रेन बैरियर, तो दे हैव टू डिपेंड ऑन ग्लूकोज, बट इन स्टार्वेशन कीटोन बॉडीज गिव एनर्जी टू द ब्रेन. एंड इफ यू टॉक अबाउट लिवर, लिवर में यू कैन सी ग्लूकोज इज देयर, देन हियर इट कैन, फास्टिंग में यू कैन से ग्लूकोज और यू कैन से फैटी एसिड्स आर देयर, बट इन स्टार्वेशन अमाइनो एसिड सर्व एज द एनर्जी फ्यूल द बॉडी. नाउ फैट स्टेट में ऑल दोज एंजाइम्स विल बी एक्टिव विच इज एक्चुअली यूटिलाइजिंग ग्लूकोज. ग्लूकोज यूटिलाइजेशन विल बी देयर इन द फैट स्टेट. जैसे ग्लूकोज विल अंडरगो ग्लाइकोलिसिस, दैट मीन्स इट विल इंक्रीज. ग्लूकोज विल अंडरगो टीसीए, टीसीए विल इंक्रीज. ग्लूकोज विल अंडरगो ग्लाइकोजेनेसिस, अगेन ग्लाइकोजेनेसिस विल इंक्रीज. एंड ग्लूकोज विल ऑल्सो बी कन्वर्टेड टू फॉर्म फैट्स और लाइपोजेनेसिस, बिकॉज देयर इज यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ दिस ग्लूकोज इन एन इफेक्टिव मैनर. नाउ लेट्स लुक एट द एंजाइम्स. अब सपोज लाइपोजेनेसिस, द रेट लिमिटिंग एंजाइम ऑफ लाइपोजेनेसिस इज एसिटाइल कोएंजाइम ए कार्बोक्सिलेज, विच इज एक्टिव ड्यूरिंग द फैट स्टेट. नाउ लेट्स सी एट द अदर ऑप्शंस आल्सो. कार्निटिन पाल्मिटोइल ट्रांसफरेस 1 और CPT1. दिस CPT1 CPT, carnitine palmitoyl transferase 1 is an enzyme of lipolysis. There is no question of this increasing in fat state. Similarly, pyruvate carboxylase, this is a rate limiting enzyme of gluconeogenesis. Again, no question of this in the fat state. And then last option is HMG lyase. Now, HMG lyase is an enzyme of HMG lyase is an enzyme of ketone bodies which is released during starvation. So, out of these only acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase, which is the rate limiting enzyme of fatty acid synthesis, will be activated during the fat state. Then next question, true regarding metabolic acidosis. Now see, metabolic acidosis mein it is again clear, acidic environment of the body is there, decreased pH is there. So obviously there will be increase in the synthesis of urea. Excretion of urea will increase and the transportable form of urea is glutamine. So the answer to this question will be, body will shunt more and more glutamine from the liver to the kidney. 125A, because glutamine when it gives out you can say that amino group, it handovers this amino group, then what happens is there is formation of alpha ketoglutarate, which is actually giving rise to bicarbonate buffer in the blood. So it is actually stabilizing it. Next, a 5-month-old baby was admitted in the pediatric ward with failure to this. Now, whenever these type of questions appear, you have to see there is a particular thing hidden in the question itself. Suppose if we see the eyes of this child, you can see ocular finding is shown below. Simple. What type of cataract is there? It is oil drop cataract. And oil drop cataract is actually due to the deficiency of what? Yeah, you can say increased concentration of what? Galactitol or dulcitol. And dulcitol or galactitol is a reduced product of galactose. 26. Answer to this is, you can say galactose. This will be forming dulcitol. Or it will be forming galactitol. And what happens is this galactose undergoes phosphorylation, forming galactose 1-phosphate. This galactose 1-phosphate undergoes epimerization with UDP glucose. There is simple epimerization, forming what? UDP galactose and glucose, or galactose 1-phosphate. So, this UDP galactose is the precursor of what? Lactose. And this will be utilized. Now, what is happening is the synthesis, you can say a defective synthesis, you can say absence of this UDP galactose uridyl transferase leads to accumulation of galactose. Increased concentration of galactose will be diverted to form increased concentration of dulcitol, which is actually responsible for this oil drop cataract. Oil drop cataract, which is a characteristic feature of galactosemia. The features are somewhat similar to hereditary fructose intolerance also, but there is no formation of cataract there. Apart from this, similar biochemical manifestations. The only difference is regarding the cataract. Oil drop cataract is a characteristic feature of galactosemia. Snowflake cataract or snowy flaky cataract for sorbitol. And another important, this is sunflower like cataract, which is actually found in deficiency of copper, Meng's disease. So, these are different type of cataracts which are observed. So, here the answer is simple galactosemia. The deficient enzyme in galactosemia is galactose 1-phosphate uridyl transferase, and there is accumulation of galactitol or dulcitol. Then 127, statement which is not correct about HDL is, now HDL, just now we discussed, HDL is heavy density lipoprotein responsible for reverse cholesterol transport. So, what are the HDL increases oxidation of LDL? By it has to be HDL, how can HDL increase the oxidation of LDL? So, the answer, this is a very simple question, answer to 127 would be the A. HDL never increases the oxidation of LDL, because their functions are antagonistic. If LDL is transporting fats from the liver to the tissues, HDL is bringing that to the liver for their degradation. So, HDL always works in an antagonistic way as what LDL works. Next, fluorescence in situ hybridization is done by. Now, see in situ hybridization. Pehle, let us look at the options. To identify specific DNA sequences, no. To map the location of mutant genes, yes. That is why this the principle involved behind this is hybridization. To identify cis-trons, no. To locate the site of replication, no. So, fluorescence in situ hybridization is actually carried by to whenever we have to identify the location of the mutant genes. Because just now I told you that there exists a single nucleotide polymorphism, there exists a restriction fragment liquid, this length polymorphism among the DNA sequences. There are certain homologous sequences which actually play a pivotal role in hybridization. So, what we do is we actually put a labeled probe. The sequence of the probe should be known to us. So, they are going to hybridize, they are going to attach with DNA at that particular homologous sequence only. If this is carried out in situ, it is in situ hybridization. And normally what we do is just to, you know, just to clarify the position where hybridization has actually occurred, we put a fluorescent into it. So, wherever the DNA molecules will hybridize, they will fluoresce. they will shine and immediately we can find it out. So this fish is a very important technique. Fish, it stands for fluorescent in situ hybridization, and normally it is carried out at the metaphase stage. Why? Because chromosomes are best viewed in this metaphase stage only. Fluorescence is there whenever DNA ki sequence, suppose here it is there AAT, whenever we add a probe, fluorescence will be there whenever there is homology in the sequences. This is actually a modification of normal in situ hybridization. The only difference is the radioactive probe is fluorescent in nature. Then next question, number 129, nucleotide repeat in telomeres results in, obviously it results in increase of the cell division. Telomeres are the sequences which are actually present at the end. They are hexanucleotides. They play a very important role in detection of cancer cells, in cell aging they play a very, very important role. Telomeres, telo means at the tail they are attached. So they are going to increase the cell division. Next question, melting temperature of DNA. Now see, melting temperature of DNA, the other name of this is TM. And how do we define this TM? Melting temperature is defined as that temperature at which half of the DNA strand, is denatured. And just now I told you ki DNA always absorbs at UV wavelength. So the absorption is on the base pair, content of the bases. Now adenine base pairs with thymine by a double bond, guanine base pairs with cytosine by a triple bond. Obviously large amount of energy is required to break this bond than this bond. So DNA which has more GC base pairs will give more absorbance than DNA which has 80 base pairs. So that DNA in which absorbance is more, yeah, optical density is more, that DNA is also known as hyperchromic DNA. Hyperchromic DNA, and that is what is the question is telling us. You can see the question, just look at the question first. Simple, melting temperature of DNA is directly proportional to the GC pairing. More the amount of GC base pairs, more will be the melting temperature, because large amount of energy will be required to break these GC base pairs. Why? Because they are linked by triple bonds. Next question, number 131, test shown in the image below is positive for, isme now again, when these type of question come, vaise to it is clear from the picture, you can see in picture 1, there is a ring like formation. And the ring is violet in color, and this violet colored ring is a characteristic feature of violet ring for Rothera's test. And Rothera's test is a specific test for ketone bodies. Rothera's, because there is actually reaction with nitroprusside, sodium nitroprusside reacts with the ketone bodies. Ketone bodies are what? Ketone bodies are actually three: acetone, acetoacetate, and beta hydroxybutyrate. Out of these three ketone bodies, acetoacetate is the primary one, because it is synthesized on a priority basis, or you can say it is the first ketone body which is synthesized. Once this acetoacetate is synthesized, it, by a dehydrogenation, will form beta hydroxybutyrate. And if it gives carbon dioxide, it will be converted to acetone. So basically in Rothera's test, what we are doing is we are taking the urine, we are adding sodium alkaline sodium nitroprusside to it, we have to saturate the urine also, and then immediately we had add liquor ammonia. The moment liquor ammonia combines with that sodium nitroprusside, it gives this violetish ring. And a very important feature about this is this beta hydroxybutyrate cannot give a positive, you cannot give Rothera's test. The reason behind this is ki beta hydro, whatever amount of beta hydroxybutyrate is produced, it is converted back to acetoacetate. And acetone, it is volatile, it will be given out as such. So Rothera's test is one test for detection of ketone bodies, other test is Gerhard's test. Both are not given by beta hydroxybutyrate. Now see, bilirubin in urine, it never gives a ring. Sugar in urine, it again does not give a ring, and uric acid again it is not giving a ring. So out of these, it is clear it has to be ketone bodies. Excretion of ketone bodies in urine is ketonuria, and increased concentration of ketone bodies in blood is ketonemia. Together it is known as ketoacidosis. And when it is combined with diabetes, because ketone bodies actually increases in starvation and DM. Now what is the reason behind that? Ketone bodies increases in starvation and DM. Very, very important. Why? Because whether it is starvation, whether it is DM, there is no proper utilization of glucose by the tissues. Now when glucose is not being utilized, you can say ki body needs energy, because heart and brain have to need to have continuous source of energy. So what will happen? There will be increased concentration of acetyl coenzyme A, which will lead to increase in the concentration of ketone bodies. So this is very, very important. Every year a question is asked on ketone bodies, and the normal concentration of ketone bodies is 0.2 millimolars. Or it is 1 milligram per dl. A renal threshold of ketone bodies is 3 milligram per dl. Then next question, the enzyme which removes hydrogen by adding oxygen is called. It's very simple. Hydrogen is being removed and oxygen is being added, none other than oxidase. It will be oxidase. Now here the students may get confused. Why? Because hydrogenase is also there, dehydrogenase. Now whenever you come across with this type of question, you see the function first. No doubt, dehydrogenase is enzyme, function is they remove hydrogen, but here oxygen is also incorporated. So that will be the function only and only of oxidase. Jaise for example xanthine oxidase is there. But if you see dehydrogenases, I will quote one example of dehydrogenases, they say LDH is there. LDH mein only hydrogen is being removed. You can see the reaction here. This pyruvic acid is converted to lactic acid or vice versa. What is happening here? If you see this reaction, this NADH plus H positive will donate their protons here, or if you look at the reverse reaction, they will after removing this, they will be converted into this. So actually in dehydrogenases only hydrogen is being removed, but here the question is saying what? You look at the question, enzyme which removes hydrogen but by adding oxygen. This is very important. So the answer to this has to be oxidase. Oxidation is occurring. Baki reductase, reduction is occurring, dehydrogenase, removal of hydrogen is there, and oxygenase, there is addition of oxygen is there. So the answer to this 132 question, very, very important, the enzyme which is removing hydrogen by adding oxygen is oxidase. Then we come over to the last question, 133, pyridoxine is a cofactor for which of the following reactions? Now see, pyridoxine, the active form of pyridoxine which actually acts in our body is, pyridoxine is nothing but vitamin B6. Active form of this is PLP, pyridoxal phosphate. Wherever by default, you always remember this PLP is a very, very important coenzyme, first for transamination and second is, it is a very, very important coenzyme of decarboxylation too. Transsulfuration, let's look at the options first. Dehydrogenation, carboxylation, decarboxylation, acetylation. Now see, for carboxylation, let's take these enzymes one by one because every year a question is generally asked on this. See, for dehydrogenation, overall if we see, the enzymes are LDH, PDH, they will come under this. Whenever we talk about carboxylation, very important question. Carboxylation always requires biotin. Examples are acetyl coenzyme A carboxylase. So many reactions are there for biotin. Then pyruvate carboxylase, means carboxylation cannot occur without biotin. Decarboxylation always requires PLP, just now I mentioned vitamin B6, and transamination also. These two reactions are very, very important for this. And the last option is acetylation. Acetylation requires pentothenic acid. Pentothenic acid, which is B5, because its active form is SH-CoA. Right. So, the answer to this question will be, pyridoxine is a cofactor for decarboxylation. Now, here we finish up with the biochemistry discussion of grand test number 185. Thank you so much.